We're gonna go straight. We like.
Okay. Oh, okay. Well, she's in charge. Okay. Okay. We're apparently we're late, so I'll keep this really short. But I just really want to welcome all of our guests today. What we're going to do is we're actually just going to go straight into Sandra's talk, and then we'll do intros when we go into our groups for the breakaways for the to discuss artificial intelligence for artists for Africa. It's going to be a really good conversation today, and you'll get a chance to sit in different groups, so you'll meet everyone. So we'll do introductions in the smaller groups. Otherwise, we'll just be here doing intros all morning. But I just want to say, we're so glad you came out here to join us in this beautiful place. This feels like a really, really important time to be discussing this topic. Things, as I'm sure a lot of you know, are moving really, really quickly in the artificial intelligence world, and we want to make sure that we are figuring out what's going to work for artists in Africa specifically, and what's going to work for Africa to keep to make sure that we, you know, we're moving forward in a responsible and ethical fashion as much as we can. So we're really interested to hear from all of you later. And I just want to say a massive thank you to the Mozilla Foundation for making this possible. Allowing us to talk about this topic this year has been so important. So thank you. You're Chennai, aren't you? Welcome. Thank you very much. Thanks for being here. Do you want to say anything about Mozilla, or you don't have to. I'm putting you totally on the spot. Yes, she's. Why don't you? Because I'll introduce the breakaway groups after this. So maybe before I do that, you can have coffee, settle in. We'll hear from Sandra, and then you can tell us a little bit about Mozilla and what you do. Okay, so without further ado, we are going to move on to a talk from the wonderful Sandra Rodriguez. She is one of, for those of you who haven't been with us this week, she's one of our advisors here at the lab. I've known Sandra for a long time. I've been a huge admirer of not just her work, but of her as a person. And I'm sure all of you who've been hanging out with her know why. She's amazing, not only because she speaks like all the languages, but she is just an incredible person to have on your side, and in this space. So thank you for being with us. And let's do that. And then afterwards, I'll tell you a little bit about how the rest of the day is going to work. Okay, great. Over to you.
I'm even gonna steal her microphone. It is moving. Thank you guys. I'm the one who's really lucky to be here. I must admit, I've felt lucky to be invited. I was always a little bit jealous of who else was invited because Electric South is a thing. When we look at who's coming, we also look at what's happening next. And we're looking at Electric South to look at the future. So it's moving so fast that I must admit, I've told everyone already, I've kept adding to my slides every day. I was like, but I need to talk about this and I need to talk about that. And this morning, I was also discovering new things that made me want to add more. So you'll see it's a lot of visuals, but still, I'm going to use the opportunity of being the last of the advisors speaking to use it as a wrap up as well. We've heard a lot about XR, AI, and innovation, and we've heard a lot about resistance. And why should we see the idea of being part of the narrative? We keep saying disrupting the narrative, but mostly it's just being part of it as an act of resistance and why we feel it's so important and something I really believe in. So XR, extended reality, artificial intelligence, just some visuals to say our world has changed. The way we share our experiences and human experiences has changed. In a way, this opens up many opportunities. You know, most of us do see things in the clouds. And what about sharing it in a different way? I love this, you know, samba dancing island because why not? You know, creativity is boundless and people are reinventing the tools to share spaces together, even at a distance. This is like the promises of social VR, but also scanning our movements, our body movements in space, and maybe using it for collective games, augmented games, and whatnot. But there's also a lot of scares. So we see artists reusing and repurposing, for instance, Midjourney to show that you could recreate this Instagram generation of influencers, but in front of catastrophes and humanitarian crises. So there are ways to disrupt the uses or reuse them to talk about things that we don't want to talk about. You know, maybe this era of visuals is not helping us really understand what's happening in the world. And of course, within these hypes, hopes, and hubris, when we see all these fears about what these tools could bring and what they mean for creators, I think sometimes there's some lessons to remember. How do we surf? I just plugged it in because there's a surf. How do we surf that wave? Every hype that we've seen, the curves of enthusiasms are all these waves of hypes. How do we surf that wave? Just that image toured on social media, and I love it because I love it. I think it's just beautiful to watch. You could watch it forever. But it also brings in, how do you start being responsible? For instance, the author of this video used Midjourney, Stable Diffusion, and Disco Diffusion. I'll talk more about tools individually, but it quotes at least where the original video is from, because there is an original video, but it doesn't quote all the images it took to create that effect. So there are still ethical questions. Now, why am I here? Why me? Why me? Why you? This is what I call the brag slide. And the brag slide started yesterday with Brett, you know, naming the beautiful project that he did in 2015 when it was first released. Do not track, where it got me really thinking about data for the first time, because that was my role also to work on the big data episode. And we used then the discussions on big data to work with the UN and create a first 360 VR interactive experience where we would showcase how Nigeria, UN in Nigeria was using data to understand where Boko Haram was, just because of prices in millet, prices in rice changing drastically, rapidly, so they could know where Boko Haram was heading and how to divert this without bringing any harm to population. So how do you bring food, for instance, if you know it's going to get stolen? So you need to play the data game. So the big picture was about learning how data influenced our lives. But then increasingly, I've been using interactive tools, including XR, VR, and artificial intelligence, to just share more about our human experiences. And because I need a bit of structure, because I wanted to share so much, I thought, okay, these are the 4 points that I want to share with us, just to have a recap of these last days. Why now? Why are we now questioning everything? Questioning these tools, reopening why we're using them. Why now? Now from where? Where are these tools? Where are the algorithms from? Who's creating them? You know, and where are the voices that are emerging? And so what now? Like, so what now is just like, can you give us some examples about all these things we're talking about? And now what? What are we going to do with all of this we've been sharing in these last days? So the first, okay, so why now? That's my kind of prerogative for the year. I like to start each year of creativity by a thing I'm going to do that year. And my year is resist the urge to be impressed. And that doesn't mean don't be impressed. I mean, the visual is great, right? But it also means we keep talking about these tools as the most powerful thing ever. So that comes with a fear of missing the boat and missing the train, because you don't want to be left out. And that blurs our idea of how we use the tools, why, and what that means. And question everything comes from a quote. The latest project I did is on Noam Chomsky, and that stayed with me. One of the phrases he keeps repeating is, growing up in the place I did, I never was aware of any other option but to question everything. Don't take things for granted. Everything is a construct, and you need to be able to question all of your assumptions. So I'm using this as a first subject to tap into, because when we talk about emergent media, we talk about accessibility, these shiny new toys that nobody has in their homes. Well, now some of you have in your home, because it was a generous offer like myself. But it's still not very accessible. We talked about media shaping and media jamming. How do we make sure that the ones creating the first contents are also creating the way the tools are adapting to the content made? And so making means making. The more you're in the maker side, the more you become the tool itself, the more you're part of how it's shaped. And then the grit, I think Diana is the one that represents for me the speech that shows more how working with any emergent media, any media, takes grit. You're always supposed to not be there. Your role is to stay there as long as you can. And I have that attitude because I come from documentary. Everything is in everything. So this is an image on the left from Chomsky versus Chomsky, the project I finished this year. And on the right, I just suddenly realized, watching these clips these gifs of the project. I'm like, hey, that looks like Rapayan. That's a documentary I shot back in 27 as a DOP, as a director of photography. Some images about Rapayan, so, and why I'm sharing this, because I come from documentary. And we shared a little bit yesterday and the day before how as documentarians, we are regarded as filmmakers. Yet when I hear, if you come from film, there's no place for you in the XR world, I question it, because it depends which type of film. A documentary is never the work of an author, it's the work of a team. It's not just the work of a team, it's a co-creative work with the people you're filming. So documentaries, this is Raul, and he's gonna tell a bit of his story.
Che ventanas por allá hay un grande torre dice que era de 20 pisos pero ahora no más tiene 6. Más adentro están los restos, cabezas, huesos. Ahí por arriba también encontramos una muñequita con un tapadito con una manta bien envolvida. Subimos y cuando subimos ahí estaba.
I love it because I heard, but it's actually a beautiful story. The mummies that they're finding are pre-Inca civilization in an archaeological site that is wider and more and older than Machu Picchu and better preserved. Yet we don't know of it because there's a highway going from Brazil to the coast paid by the narco traffickers in the regions that are also paying for school, electricity, water, drinkable water, and the internet. So the dilemma of the village was that we were there following Peruvian archaeologists who thought this is an amazing discovery. And the citizens were like, screw the discovery. I want my kids to go to school. I want them to have access to a broader education. So whose view are we filming? So here is us filming. It's 3,500 meters high. We're in altitude, we're chewing coca because it's the only way we can kind of cope with the altitude. And our story is that we're filming the great discovery by the Peruvian archaeologists, but also how the community disagrees with their views. And meanwhile, this is the first picture that was ever posted on Rapayan's official Facebook page, because Facebook just got big in 2007. 2006 in Rapayan, there was no electricity. 2007, there was a Facebook page. That's just when we talk about quick appropriation now of technology, that really depends of where you are. In that case, I think they were really faster. They were ready for it. They've been waiting for it so long that when it got there, they beat us at it. They really were faster than we were. And it made me think, who tells the story? Their story was like, look at this little gringos that are coming here to film, you know, the ruins, and it's hilarious, but maybe there's money to be made out of this. Why I showed Raul is Raul was the only citizen that wanted to only speak Quechua. He didn't want to learn Spanish or English or French like the other kids. He wanted to keep on speaking Quechua, and he wanted to preserve the mummies. So the younger generation wanted to preserve the past, their parents wanting them to have a future. You know, who tells the story? That's another thing that made me think yesterday of, you know, documentaries with the people that you're talking about. What happens about memory? Documentaries become a way to archive moments in our human lives and with a very subjective view. But what happens in this case in 2013, I was filming a documentary called We Were There. And these are old revolutionary priests that were part of the Che Guevara revolution in the 1960s in Bolivia. And they don't remember anything. The sound is bad, but it's okay. It's just trying to shoot a documentary. They were very proud of certain things they could never find. They're like, but I was sure it was here. But I'm sure it's here. Villa Bush, I mean, that's where we hid weapons. Miguel on the right hand side has Alzheimer's, so shooting every day and just making sure he agreed for me to put a mic on him was a struggle, because he would remember me, but wouldn't remember why I was like wanting to get something down his shirt and into the design of his pants. So it was a little bit of a struggle each day. But this just made me think, who tells the stories when we don't remember certain traces? So in a way, data gives us an opportunity for traces, but so many of these are not online. And when we're saying it's a reflection of who we are, it's a biased reflection, we've talked about it, but it's also a snapshot reflection of so many things that weren't digitized. We produce a lot of data each year, but a lot of our history as human beings is not data and hasn't been digitized and is even forgotten. So where does that lead us? You see, I'm like very theorizing a lot of these stuff. I think it was Diana who said during our talks, like, first make a living, make sure you can pay your rent, and then you can, you know, have more time to create. That's what I did. That's why I chose to do a PhD, truth be told. I was working on documentary films. You have no revenue whatsoever. And I thought, well, I'm really good at talking about the way we're using these tools. Maybe if I get a funding to do my PhD, then I'll do the PhD. If I don't get funding, I don't do it. Skip it. I don't care. So that's why I don't care that much about my own PhD. But then it's a trap, because they keep you in forever. And they keep you in forever because they get money because they have you as a funder. So I started to think, okay, well, as long as I'm here, let's make it worthwhile. What are the tools that we're using today to create media, and that therefore, now we all know Marshall McLuhan creates meaning. So I'm sorry for those of you who just arrived, that was kind of an inside joke yesterday. The theoretician Marshall McLuhan that says the media is the message was quoted by three of the speakers. But this is the idea. If we're creating the media, then we're creating the meaning. What is the media of the now? And my media of the now was social media. And I started to look into how a younger generation was using social media to bring cultural change. Weirdly, they never believed there was really social movements on social media. And they all believed in something that would happen later for perpetuity. And not thinking this is going to change everything, but this is my way to make sure this voice still disrupts the narrative. So it's a constant fight. Or making sense of social change today. It's a slow rippling movement, not believing into changing structures and powers, or sometimes disbelieving in your capacity to change structures means you try to have ripple effects, just like birds and starlings. That was my PhD at the time. I renamed it because PhD titles are awful. So I called it the starling effect. How are birds looking at other birds to figure out how to fly in patterns? I was looking at you. And the idea is that it kept on going. So I had a dual life where on one end, I was asked to consult with game companies, talk about how younger generations were using tools to share meanings, recreate meanings, but also that led me to working with Ubisoft to talk about UX, you know, how easy it is to navigate and how clunky it is sometimes and what does it mean? And that was a totally parallel life to filmmaking up until then. But it led me into think about remix culture. Segue into Brett. People were using it, even the memes. Memes mean something. And we're using memes because people are saying this is the me generation. Really? Well, they have, you know, less healthcare and less security and less income than you guys did. So why are you thinking they're so selfish? And suddenly it became like the unemployed generation, and the meme went on to just become a meme. Oh my God, pizza. So I taught a class. I realized that it was in sociology of technology and nobody was teaching digital humanities in my University of Montreal. So here is for the underdogs. Every time my way of working is to think, what do I have that I can give? And how is that useful for somebody else? So I thought, well, I'm here. I can teach a class. I was told they're not going to be interested in that class. You're going to talk about sociology of the web and social media and Web 2.0. They know all this shit. They don't want somebody to be teaching them about it. But I thought, no, we need a class where you can think this through. So I started teaching a class called Sociology of the Web. And I taught RIP, a remix manifesto. And I thought about it yesterday when you were showing your clips. I was like, hey, true, I knew Red before I knew Red. That's fun. But we would talk about things like this, you know, and you don't have to be religious to just see the difference between the vigil of the Pope in 2005 with one flip phone in that image and maybe another like way back then And then a couple of years later, everybody's filming the vigil on their phones. So got me thinking into, okay, yes, we've got data, and data is not just traces. Data tells stories. People tell stories. Participants tell stories. Data can tell stories. We can use data to visualize our stories with data. So this on the right, for instance, We Feel Fine is an old project, but in 2006, Jonathan Harris was looking at how people said, I feel online, on Twitter specifically. And you could really see one day where I feel pretty was really, really in that day versus I feel sad. You could see clusters of emotions emoting from how people shared the tag, I feel something. Not even a tag, just using the words I feel followed by something else. And then it got me talking even back way back then about, you know, work that helps us see that using data to see helps you also see differently. What about the things around you? Could they become creative tools? You know, using AI to just use your face or use objects to make them and turn them into something fully radically different. How interesting is that? And what do you want to do with it? And of course, at the same time, we kept talking about deep fake. So again, opportunities versus dangers. So Deke, now I'm trying to do recap. That's my first part, recap about some of this. Recap talked about the age of the unreal. And I thought, yes, why now? Because we're in an age of the unreal, where we keep inventing terminologies and finding ways for them to make sense. Like, is it an improved reality? Is it an alternate reality? Is it escapism? Is it fake news that's taking over? Are we faking things? Are we emulating things? The words we use have weight and they have a lot of repercussions. But at the same time, instead of focusing on words, if we're focusing on art, art can help demystify, wanted to say the technology because it does, but it can also help demystify the now. Our life now is not just technology, but our life now is completely tethered to technology. So the role of the artist is always to question the now. What does living now mean to you? And technology is increasingly worldwide a part of everything we do. And as you'll see, it even gets into your pants. I've said that twice now in my talk. Getting into someone's pants. But I like this last quote because I keep thinking about it a lot as well. Media artists, and some people told me AI is not a media, and that's an entire academic debate on the terminology media. We think media, we think radio, TV. Media means also fabric. Mediated matter means something that transmits. So light can be a media, water can be media. So terminology media is also itself loaded. So let's just make sure that we understand that it means things that put us into relation, things that carry imagination, and things that we can use that to create a bit of empathy. What is it that creates our human lives, and how are the layers of these lives? So media artists that use any type of media are constantly contributing to the development of the medium. Because the more you invent and create with that medium, that becomes what the medium can become tomorrow. So you're constantly creating and contributing to the development of the medium. So in a way, you're an artist, but you're also a scientist. Because, you know, if not for art, then there's no innovation. The tool is just a tool, and then you just use it, and it's a toaster. So how come it becomes something else? Oh, now I feel a little bit more restless because many points to recap. 3 days of your brain exploding of information, and I'm going to do it again. But it's a bit of a recap. But now, okay, so that's the thing. And then, so why, who, where are we now? We keep talking about XR, but you also hear the terminology emergent media more and more. Why? Because, well, initially it was all about immersiveness. So much so that we say virtual reality, augmented reality, mixed reality. We'll just call it extended because it means anything that extends from reality. But the terminology reality was still here or used. Now, extended media is more, well, anything that's the new tool, the new shiny tech that we're all like flies to, moths to the light. And we're like, whoo, you know, the new technology arrives and whoo. And there are a lot of emergent media artists, and I consider myself one of them. I don't want to be attached to new technology and want technology for technology's sake. But every time it's like opening a new window or door into opportunities and you don't want to miss out. So how do you level that without getting too impressed? It's like paying attention, looking at the light, but before you get grilled into the light, don't get too impressed. Like, look at it sideways. Get acquainted with it. So again, I did it again. In 2015, I received a fund to do a postdoc, this time at the MIT Open Documentary Lab, with our good friends of the MIT Open Doc Lab. And I was there as a visiting scholar for a year. And when you're a fellow at the Open Doc Lab, you're there for a year. But then I'm there. What can I do that's going to be meaningful while I'm here? And I thought, well, I'm working in VR more and more, and it's but now 2015, 2016, I don't see any VR classes taught at MIT. So again, for the underdogs, you were talking yesterday about the imposter syndrome. You can also decide that since we are all imposters, why not just give it a go? And I thought, okay, again. So I went to the head of the department and I said, there are no classes taught about VR creation. All your students are just learning about VR and they don't access tools. And William Uricchio, who is the director of the lab, said, that's a great idea. Let's go to the department. Let's make sure we have a class. They suggested a workshop. If you can get 20 students, maybe we turn it into a regular workshop. We got 320 applicants, a third of them from Harvard, other universities as well that are famous in the region, but less internationally, like Northeastern University, Mass Arts. Universities were knocking doors. We want in. Oh my God, what do I do with this? And what do I do with all these students that I want to get in and I don't have access and I don't have equipment? Let's just hack XR. Let's just make sure that we sometimes lie a little bit our way in and use competition to our advantage. So we called HP and we told them we were already in discussions with Oculus. And HP gave us computers. And then we called Oculus and we said, hey, Yelena, for those of you who know her, hey, Yelena, we have a deal with HP. We have computers. We don't have any headsets. Do you mind sharing some headsets with us? And she said, we're actually targeting some universities. Of course, MIT would be like on our list. Let's share some headsets. And then we asked the department, we have headsets. We don't have space. We have computers. Can I get a space to create a lab? And they said, no, but we have this unused room for storage. So I spent a month cleaning that room, with like emptying the boxes, the carton boxes, finding what to donate to whom and what I couldn't donate and didn't donate, and then set up a lab with like images to inspire the students. We have a lab, and students were excited, and so was I. So Hacking XR, everybody expected them to, you know, we made news, MIT News again, yay for the underdogs. I'm boasting. And I'm boasting with pride, because when you have an underdog approach, you're not supposed to be there. You're just pushing your way through. And if you don't talk about this to others, how are they inspired to do the same, right? So MIT News, what I liked is that at least they were curious, because we were exploring technical, philosophical, and artful dimensions of VR. And they expected students to want to do this. Like, okay, what if it's working and I want to work at Bombardier? And what if I, you know, because they're engineers. But sorry, I'm like assuming everybody knows what Massachusetts Institute of Technology is. But MIT is a school of engineering, so mostly. So they're there as engineers. But some of the engineers decided to partner. And that was a little how the class was constructed, making sure a third were engineers, developers, programmers, techies, let's call them. And then a good third were storytellers. They wanted to say something and they had experience, or sometimes they didn't. And then a third were weird wild cards that I thought would just contribute, because I don't know what to expect. It's an emergent media. I don't have all the answers. So if you tell me you do parkour like Karen Palmer did, and one of the applicants said, I have no skill in anything that relates to storytelling, film, media, or VR, but I do parkour and I'm very good at it. It was like, maybe you deserve a chance. Why not? So they started mingling together. And so that is a first year student in engineering who didn't know anything about storytelling, matched with a seasoned war photographer. And it made me think yesterday when we were seeing Violeta, they did exactly the same thing. They did a space where they had like a gallery where you could interact with people of elderly portraits. But when you interacted with them, you would hear their story. But if you looked away, they would disappear and you would never find them again. So it was about memory loss and like just losing a sense of touch. And I felt it was so poetic. So yes, engineer students matched with non-engineer students can create beauty and magic and poetry. And some of them really just went along. Story, feeling, just emotion. So it's not the best, but I was just surprised. That was the first year students and nobody expected them to want to create, convey meaning, convey emotions and tell stories. And yet humans are humans. So I'm talking about this just because I wanted this to relate to you guys. Well, yeah, we've all been talking about what we do, but how does that relate to me? The first learning of this class was that concept and vision or art and design often go hand in hand. You may not be the best artist, but when you're imagining something, you kind of have a sense of what it will look like and feel like. So it's easier for somebody with a concept and vision to share it and talk about it with artistic design. But sometimes the tools and platform really talk well to the UX because you know the affordances of the tools, so you really know how to use it best and what type of interactivity, but then they don't talk to each other. And it's really hard to make sure, when we were told in these last days, don't choose the tech too soon, but sometimes that's what's inspiring you, or don't, you know, what's your story first, which is really important too, and then don't think about the tech. And all of this is kind of true. It really depends of what's attracting you to that field of emergent media. Is it the tool and you want to debunk it and understand it? And that could also be fine. So sometimes I wanted to bring back, if you have concept vision and you kind of know what the story will look like and how it will feel like, we'll learn about the affordance of the tool, even though it's not the final tool. What are the UX that you want? What's the type of interactions that speak to you? And that will get you to talk about the other side. What's the best platform then for what you want to do? And of course, it doesn't have to be a one straight line. You can really go into any direction, and it's really up for you to create this pattern where you understand what's meaningful to you the most and why you're there, why you want to do this. Is it just because this technology fascinates you? And I'm bringing it back not because I disagree with any other of the speakers. I also usually favor story first and meaning first. But sometimes it's because I hear of a technology getting developed that really intrigues me, that I want to use that technology. And so that technology becomes the story as well. So don't forget that. And last, about human-centered design. Humans, we keep saying, make it simple. We want it super simple. Super simple, cats. And then the cats go, meow, meow. But that's, I love users. We you know, yesterday I was mentioning human-centered design. We often say it because it's true. We don't want to treat them like users. They're not just users, they're human. But my personal take on human-centered design is that because the users are human, they also come with physical affordances. And we often forget that. I'm going to get into some examples so you know a bit more of what this means. Sorry, I added some slides about not like being weird and failing. We've mentioned so much and it's so useful. So after being the first VR class at MIT, woo, making headlines. We made headlines again because in 2021, we were the first VR class about VR. We did the entire class in VR, and that's what it looked like. I was teaching to like dogs and gorillas, and I didn't really care. We had field trip and VR chat. So the class was not super serious. But that's partly because why not have fun? The only place where I do agree, like break things, is when it's a playground, not when it's a society. But if it's a playground, why not? Like this, just, you know, disrupt. I also wanted to show another brag slide. It was just to say opportunities to see outside the box. my prerogative was, I don't know more than any of you know. We all know best about our experience and where that brought us. So I would invite guests, and I never was able to invite Ingrid because we didn't have funds for travel. So I could just invite guests that were either very local or traveling themselves already in New York at MIT, just to make sure that the students were see other approaches, not just mine, and sometimes people that disagreed with me, just because that's part of learning about an ecosystem that's fully developing and constantly morphing. So human affordances, I'm going to start bringing in videos about projects, and I know it's way too long, so I want to look in time because we didn't start exactly at the time. So if I'm way too long, you guys tell me. If it's way too slow, same thing. Now that I have a microphone in my hand, you're less likely to raise your hand. So please remember that you can do at any time. So human affordances, I started really thinking more about, we have bodies that have their own affordances. And when we're talking about UX design, it's all about what will the user do? How can we bring their attention? How do we make sure that curiosity doesn't break everything? And I kept thinking, but we are human, therefore curious. So why don't we just reward that curiosity? That's a human affordance. Like, let's not take it out. For those of you who may not be familiar with the term affordance, it's what's specifically unique to that tool that you're using that makes it just intuitively what you need to use. For instance, a doorknob, you understand that that's to open the door. You don't have to be explained. You kind of understand you can turn it or leverage it. But if it doesn't have a doorknob, then, you know, maybe it has something and you know you can push it. So an affordance is something that is unique to the tool. So if humans have affordances, that means we have some things that are unique to humans, like curiosity. Why don't we reward it? Why do we keep telling people what to do in VR? Just be yourself and discover. And maybe if then they are satisfied that they are respected in their curiosity, they're going to enjoy it. What more? We want to talk about stories. So make it a team project. So Tara yesterday said, this was your project. I didn't know this was your project. I said, well, it wasn't mine, first of all. And I'll tell you about the project first. But if it's a team, and I insisted from the beginning that we would remain a team when we apply, when we present into festivals, that we remain a team, because I believed I didn't create this by myself, and it's not even my story. So let me tell you about the story. Kalina Bertin Kalina Bertin is a young filmmaker that decided to study film so she could talk about her dad. Her dad, she never really knew quite well. She knew he had a very eccentric life, and every time she was with him, he was called by different names. And one day, years after he left the family and she hadn't seen him for like 12 years, they learned that he was assassinated. They were like, assassinated? Yeah, it's a homicide by his wife. His wife, like, she had a lot of questions. She discovered that he had multiple personalities. He was bipolar, invented a sect in the US, was arrested for pretending he was the songwriter for the Rolling Stones. He had four families simultaneously that didn't know of each other. She discovered out of the 14 brothers and sisters that didn't know each other, everybody had bipolar disorder, and she's the only one that doesn't have it. So she started to feel, I need to share that story. She learned how to use a camera to talk about how it felt to be with her brother and sister, who started on their journey to becoming bipolar type 1 while she was filming them. What that means is when you lose touch with reality and you go into psychosis. So not every bipolar person goes into psychosis. But in this particular case, both her brother and sister would go into psychosis, completely lose touch with reality. And they do what a lot of bipolar do when they are in psychosis. They call and leave recordings. If you will pick up the phone, they will often hang up. But it's a trait I didn't know was very regular. They will record themselves or leave recordings of what they're going through. So she had all these voice recordings. And the documentary was just following the day-to-day life of her sister having an 8-year-old child that will tell her in the morning, Mom, it's happening again. Mom, we need to get you to the doctor. So you could see the aftermath of what happens to you and how that affects everyone, but you could really see what was happening inside. So when she approached me to say, we want to do a VR film that will show how it feels to be a manic depressive, again, resist the urge to be impressed. And like, that sounds great and terrifying. I'm not sure. Let's talk to psychiatrists. Let's talk to your brother and sister first, and then let's talk to psychiatrists. And we just started a conversation. What are you afraid about if I'm telling you we're going to do a project about this? And everybody said, I'm afraid you're going to pretend that you're in somebody's mind that has bipolar disorder. You're just appropriating their story as everybody else's story. And it's nobody is the same. So how do you talk about manic depression in a way that can include everyone? And we looked at materials. So like a documentarian, what are your materials? And the best material we had were the voice recording. So the documentary are the real voice recording messages that we used. And on top of that, we said, okay, so what's our UX design? And the UX design is that of the disorder. Every psychiatrist we talked to said, if you say you're in the head of somebody that has bipolar disorder, I don't want to participate in your project. But if you say that it's to show how the cyclical effect is so natural that we would probably all fall for the cyclical effect, were we given the chance, it's hell. And if you can share that hell, then we fully believe in it. So we thought, okay, what do we have as tools that help you feel the hype of mania to the point where you're losing touch with reality, in that case, their story? We're just like giving users so much control over the world. They're like, oh, this is so much fun. They're no longer listening to the voiceover until we take that control away. And they freak out. Okay, now transparency card. I didn't think the project was that great. And not because I'm difficult. I think it had flaws, a lot of flaws and a lot of things we skipped through. But the meaning was strong. And the boast slide is now, again, we won the first Ars Electronica Award for a VR project, the Golden Nika. So it's a huge award. Thank you. For a project that we all went like, talk about imposter syndrome. Four of us as director were like, really? What? Are you sure it's the right title? Because we had a lot of people tell us, yeah, it's fun, but it's not that great. I'm like, yeah, but it has a meaning. And humans relate to meaning more than they do to tech. So this is what it looked like.
Hi, Quena. It's me. I think it started again.
Quena, what do I do with this?
The madness and love, the crazy love. This is what this is.
I had a magical belief that, just like Jesus, I had supernatural powers. God had a plan for me.
Everything that has ever been is within us. Each soul can be free. Isn't that enough? Just be alive?
It's very poetic. I was visited by all these spirits. That was strange. It's like if half of it is true and half of it is in my mind. The world becomes a scary place.
So you see the, like, they're actually triangles flying, so you could decide they're birds or bats or insects. We base that interaction on super hot. We watch a lot of games on, you know, in VR to get inspired for the interaction, so please do the same. It doesn't mean that because you're wanting to do a really profound project, you can't get inspired by, you know, Beat Saber. In our case, super hot, we felt was so, brought so much anxiety because you will now discover the game. The speed of your body controls the speed of the things attacking you. And it's really giving you a sense of control, no control. the control you have is not is negative. So you kind of have to learn to stand still and stop. And we felt it spoke to what the psychiatrists were telling us about manic depression. They need to, when they're losing control, they just want to gain it again. So they will do everything, including stopping their meds, so they can get back to that happy place where they are Jesus, as we were, you know, as we saw. And they don't want to crash and feel the loss of control, but you need to learn to stand still and just let that frustration become part of your reality. So one part of the conclusion now is like, okay, so the percept, what I liked about this project is what we were trying to tap into were our lives have multiple layers. And what I think could be useful to you guys and your projects, for what I've heard, is that a lot of times it's about bringing empathy about a subject, bringing awareness about a subject, but just think of the many layers of that subject and how you can relate to that subject in many layers. Is it physical? For instance, we were talking about like a capacity for softness. Is it something in your movement? Is it something in the way you interact with things? You know, can you use frustration of the technology as a UX? Because you can really get angry, but can you use that in the storytelling? So I just like this quote because our technology is great and it can be great, but it's not never as great as your imagination. So use the flaws of the technology and the affordances of your body and suddenly you can create magic. And this I added in way too last minute last night. oh my God, the world is a crazy place. We talked about responsibility for what you're doing and how privilege can also sometimes open doors into the underprivileged. Sometimes you are privileged and then you have a door to more privilege. What will you do with that privilege? And while at MIT, some people call MIT the militarized institution of technology. And I'm just teaching a class where we're doing what we're doing here. No more, nor less. And not with students that are smarter or more creative. No more, nor less. And yet I get an email that says, I'm writing blah, blah, blah. We're working on a video project for the CIA. Pardon? That's a real email I got. No, not yesterday, but 2022. We'd love for you to be involved. Okay, so they do these videos for the CIA where they ask MIT experts, in this case, 7 MIT experts, to talk about AI, blockchain, cybersecurity, digital twin, and more. Is it my opportunity to change that? No, it's not. I just refuse. I decided not to participate. But I remember my inner discussion. Is it my opportunity to be one of the 7 people that may change their mind? It's a huge machine. I'm not there to change their mind. They want to hear where it's heading. But I just thought, why ask me? Because they don't know who to ask. And suddenly you're the underdog. You're at the right place at the right time, and you can speak in a microphone like I'm doing now. Well, maybe we should put you on a camera and you're one of the 7. That's how knowledge gets transmitted sometimes. Just privilege. Problem, yeah? Right. I know Brian's like, uh-huh. So I know. And that's the thing. So when you do get that privilege, what do you do with it? And you could have accepted and really decide that you're the ones going to change their minds, but I just asked, what is it going to be used for? And they said, oh, it's going to be shared with the community in a year or two. But meanwhile, it's just shared within the CIA for internal uses. And I thought, okay, I don't know how what I'm going to say is going to use and by whom. I don't want to be part of it. So I just declined. There's more to life than the CIA. There's more to life than AI. I'm really long, but I'm told you guys being last means that I want to talk about everything. And I'm a talker. Okay. There's no hurry, but there's a tension span. So I'm like in between both. So now more projects, because now you've seen a bit. Okay, enough about you. We want to see the projects and we want to learn about how they get made. And lesson 023, that was not intended. I thought that was supposed to be a B, but there's more to life than AI. So remember I was showing you this and that was like... Sorry, things that inspire me. Sorry for those that don't see that I'm coughing, that don't know that I've been coughing for all these last days and just hear me because I forgot that we're also with Zoom people. Apologies for coughing in a microphone. These were things that were inspiring me in 2018 about how impressive the technology was, and this is what you can do this year with Runway. We've seen some examples of Runway. So these are videos completely generated by AI with just a couple of prompts. The quality is, I don't know how to define it. Resist the urge to be impressed. It is impressive, but it's also now cliche. I'm starting to recognize Midjourney style versus DALL-E. So yeah, okay. You know, that's one thing. So two projects, two very extreme projects. I didn't do it on purpose, but this took forever. We started officially in 2017, Chomsky versus Chomsky. Sex, Desires, and Data, we started in 2021. And they were not meant to end at the same time, but I had two premieres back-to-back in Montreal, and it was the year of mayhem, because, of course, it's draining. But it were two big projects that both demystified AI in very different ways. So let's talk about the first. Chomsky versus Chomsky is a very intellectual, meta, quirky project that uses AI to talk about AI through AI. Who here has never heard the name Noam Chomsky? Okay, very good. Who here has heard the name Malkovich? Or hasn't heard the name Malkovich? Okay. A couple of years ago, there was a movie called Being John Malkovich. I didn't know. Everybody went to see the movie. Oh, you know Malkovich, right? And I was like, smile and nod. And then I saw the movie and had nothing to do with John Malkovich. And it was just weird. And it just said Malkovich, Malkovich, Malkovich in the movie a lot. And it felt the same for me about Chomsky. So Chomsky is a philosopher, linguist, activist in the United States and at MIT, worked at MIT for 65 years. Some people consider him one of the founders of cognitive theory. But he has a reputation as a linguist for creating that theory of universal grammar that we all have inside a sort of system that allows us with very, very finite means to create infinite meanings. So a baby will learn any language, right? Because it has a system that with very similar triggers will just be able to talk any language. It's not very well defined, but it's always hard to say who is Noam Chomsky quickly. But he's also a famous activist. So in a way, a lot of people have heard his name without even knowing who he is, and we don't really care, but you'll see why Noam Chomsky. So while at MIT, again, we're all talking about big data, and there's Siri already there, and everybody's calling it AI, and then there was a debate, but that's not really AI, but that is really AI, and everybody kept bickering at each other of who had the right definition of AI. But the reality is AI is not one thing, it's an umbrella of many technologies that, as we were told yesterday, emulate things that we attribute with subjective qualities as tasks that a human could perform. But humans can perform a lot of things that we're not even suggesting AI will. And there were fears about deepfakes. You know, maybe we can deepfake somebody. And at the same time, there's this young researcher, Yarden Katz, who comes up to me and says, I am a huge fan of Noam Chomsky. I have many hard drives of all of his talks. And I know that whenever he talks with his hand like this, he's angry. But when he looks this way, he's happy. And when he doesn't like your question, he has a... So, okay. He said, if I could really get all the data about Noam Chomsky, I could map out the way he thinks and he could live forever. And I thought, you're really smart. Do you believe what you're saying? That... I'm not sure I follow. Have you talked about it with Chomsky? And he said, are you kidding? Of course not. I was like, okay. He goes, I have interviewed Chomsky and he disagrees with everything. And I thought, okay, this is hilarious. So I really tried to get, because I'm a believer in co-creation, really tried to get Yarden along the way. He was sure there was money to be made into it. I was sure there was a message into it. He decided not to be part of the project. But the goal was that I kept feeling that he saw in AI the opportunity to see what makes Chomsky's brain unique, use it to monetize a way of being, something is off. And for me, it missed the point. AI is better and faster at us. Finding Waldo. You know these kind of books? Yeah, Find Waldo. So some would say that AI system is better than me. I disagree. I think it lost the game. The game is not finding Waldo. It's searching for it. Win for Sandra! It missed the entire pleasure of playing it. There's no pleasure in that game. Like, okay, you found it. Great. Next page, great. Next page, great. Done. That's not finding Waldo. That makes no sense. So, again, so why these technologies? Why now? And why Chomsky? And whenever we talk about AI, the promise is it could sound human. It could look human. It could replace humans. We're so human obsessed. Why? Why not an octopus? Like, I'm not sure. Like, why do we insist for it to have to be human? Why do we need to replace that many humans? Maybe because, you know, we can't do it and it's obsessing us because we need to control everything. What I like, you've missed that, but because I talk too much. But when the, I could be an architect. I could be, have you seen this? Like, you see the ad and these avatars are fully non-human. They're completely made by AI. And when he says, I could be an artist, I don't know why he frowns all of a sudden. There's like, I could be an architect. I could be a doctor. I could be an artist. Even the AI is not sure that's for him. And yet we're so good at it. So that was the promise. The promise is it's going to replace us. And then humans go, wait a minute, Midjourney is now accessible to everyone. Let me put the Pope in Balenciaga coats. And that went viral. So you've got like 15 years of fast, not that fast, generative image development that went completely under the radar. But as soon as a human takes it and disrupts the narrative and everybody goes, whoa, whoa, you can do what? It's wearing Balenciaga coats? Is it for real? And we get excited and suddenly we say it picked up speed. But is it the technology that's going fast? We keep, again, I'm like just disrupting your narrative here. I think the humans are the ones going fast. You made that public. We changed it. And nobody was expecting that to happen because nobody expected humans, which is the weirdest thing in this equation. Humans are really fast. So I just love this. DALL-E 2 posted that image because it thought it really broke like something when the image could be that good that the prompt, an astronaut riding a horse, got that image. And that was their pride because it's almost there, right? And it was always the discussion that we need more data. The more the data, the better. The more the data, the better, you know? Big data is a thing. People want more data because more data will mean more accuracy. Actually, it's being demystified. Some of these systems are using less and less data for it to be more accurate and not have the horse ride the astronaut. And so these systems use less data, but they steal more data. Less IP respected, more accuracy. So it's not the things we say when we talk about AI are not always true. And sometimes we will obfuscate why we say them in a certain things by saying it's to make them simple to understand. For instance, metaphors about how it relates to your brain. But it's not necessarily just to make it simple. It's also to make it believable. Ta-da! Everybody talks about AI for 7 years now. What is left to say? What's left to say is that a lot of humans are hiding behind the machine to pretend the machine runs well. Ooh, what? Are you kidding? That's my moment where everybody goes like, ah, we knew that. Even today, ChatGPT hires people around the world that are really not well paid to just do little tasks of correcting, constantly correcting. So you could be chatting with ChatGPT and it's the machine. And sometimes it's a human. And sometimes it's human reviewing the answer and the next day you get a better answer. But machines are hiding, humans are hiding behind the machine. I love this little joke, right? What do you do for a living? I pretend to be a computer that has taken my job. And for me, it's the biggest break in the narrative. We are getting ourselves accustomed. Oh, sorry, guys are taking pictures. I'm going to bring it back. Because the joke is a joke and you want to repeat the joke. It's Janelle Shane who wrote a book that I bought just because of the title. It says, you look like a thing and I love you. And that's the best pickup line her chatbot could generate. But the title of the book. And I love it because she really helps demystify AI. But in part, what it leaves behind, so why I'm bringing all of this, not just to make you laugh, it's also because breaking the narrative is demystifying even the myths we keep carrying without noticing with the words that we're using to talk about AI. And it leaves away the question of choice. Oh, finally, she's going to show us a trailer. How can we take part in steering the future? That was the narrative of Chomsky versus Chomsky. I thought, okay, I'm going to show you. This was our trailer for what we showed in 2022. On the right hand, this is actually today's masterclass by Noam Chomsky that you can access online. And I just thought they looked so much the same. But the idea is that Noam Chomsky is a scholar, philosopher, thinker. And he is one of the intellectuals with the most digitized digital trace available. So I'm sure I could find as much data. Since the 1950s, he's been interviewed about every topic. And he gives all of his interviews free of rights. So they're all accessible online. And he's been interviewed really about Palestine, US economy, linguistics, monkeys, love, and sandwiches. It's just about everything. People see him like a human computer, and they will ask anything of Noam Chomsky. And his personality is also to have a prerogative to demystify what breaks away our free will and our capacity for creativity. So, of course, it becomes a huge material data set to create a chatbot. And I'm sure I could use the same with the Kardashians. I'd probably just have as much data, maybe more available. But Noam Chomsky has also devoted his life to studying the human mind. So it made me think, okay, we have something here. I didn't know what I had in my hands. I just thought, I know that isn't it great to be able to create an entity that could tell you you're never going to be able to really replicate Noam Chomsky? It's just very meta, but I love the meta. And what I discovered by searching was that Noam Chomsky's ramification into AI were wider than I expected. His theory on universal grammar is highly attached to natural language. Natural language means what I said before. We all have an inner capacity for language. And even if I don't know a language, I can pick it up quickly because I have a capacity for it. Natural language processing is really inspired by natural language. So much so that in programming, you have Chomskyan logics and Chomskyan grammar semantics that are used in AI programming, natural language processing, but they have nothing to do with his real theories. They are just invented in the same building, privilege. So the same building at MIT had philosophy, linguistics, AI, and computer science in the same building. So when these guys are creating natural language processing, they didn't know what to call it. And they go, well, it's just like the natural language thing, but for computers. So it doesn't mean it actually is. It's just we find ways to create meanings, and these meanings suddenly have weight. This is the prototype represented in 2020.
I have been asked questions for my life. Everybody wants to know. Defining intelligence is a colossal problem, way beyond the limits of our understanding. We have to be humble. We really are in a pre-Galilean stage. We don't know what we are looking for any more than Galileo did. There is an instinct for freedom at the core of human nature, to inquire, to create. You are the countless number of people, the driving force in history. It is up to you to decide. You can duplicate me. But the question is myself actually myself?
Weird. Super weird project, but it was a prototype. People thought it was the end game result. It was just a prototype, but I want to talk about how we made it. So very different methods. One that I took from documentary, go to the source. Chomsky left 65 years of notes that he took from his talks at MIT to the MIT Library Archives collection. So I went there and I looked at archives And I saw drawings he makes when he's babysitting his grandkids. And I saw notes skip, 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 like things he finds important, things that he prefers and really will highlight or draw around, and things where there are coffee stains. And I tried to just get inspired of some of these traces, but also things that were relevant to him. And I call them these golden nuggets. So what you've heard in the trailer are like golden nuggets, things that he's been repeating for over 65 years. And in his talks, he highlights, it means it's meaningful to him. So that's important. We also talked to Noam Chomsky, underdog. Again, why not? Really, you did what? I emailed Chomsky. His reputation is to say yes to every interview request. Why wouldn't I just write to him? So I thought, am I really writing to him? Actually, no, I wrote to his wife. I didn't know. But I wrote an email that was so long that he responded, my wife and I have been reading your letter. And I thought it was hilarious. Sorry. But Chomsky knows of the project. Sorry, I'm going to take just a bit of water. And cough into the microphone. So Chomsky's aware of the project. He's been aware of every step of the project. We didn't interview him for the project. He didn't participate with an interview for the project. That's our promise was, we're using your data that you've given online for free. His response, I love the man for it. He said, you don't need my permission. It's open source. Just use it. And we said, yeah, but it's the National Film Board of Canada. We really need a letter. So their letter is that it's accepting it as a fair use of his data. So everybody's like, but is he part of the project? No. The goal is not to make a project about Noam Chomsky with Noam Chomsky. It's to make a project about AI with AI. So we're just using his data and his consent. But he pointed us to the Chomsky.info archives, which are curated by his family and Chomsky fans all over the world. So like Wikipedia, people share his talks. The data set became easier because people identified with tags. So you could suddenly have all this data, but also identified subject topics of interest, hot subjects, hot topics, etc. And what you saw, we didn't use very elegant AI. It's not even GPT-2. It's like the beginnings of GPT-2. So for those of you who know a little bit more about AI or less, no content was really generated. We did use AI for speech to text. So you could speak in a microphone and there's an AI system that translates it to text. From text, we use an AI system that tries to evaluate sentiment analysis. So what is it about? Are you talking about food? Are you talking about politics? Is it the weather? Are you just chit-chatting? What is it? And then we had, that's intent analysis, and then sentiment analysis, which is like, are you like ironic? Are you happy? Are you disagreeing with me? Are you unhappy? So that's the sentiment analysis. It doesn't recognize your face, but it's more like, you piece of, well, it's not negative, like negative. Or, oh my God, you're so funny, positive. You know, so it's just trying to see where the conversation is at so we could match it to an answer in the database. That's all that it did. But people were asking questions like, what should we do about climate? That's how little and specialized the project was. And people were asking, do animals have language? Are we doomed to be extinguished? Do you like pizza? What do you do with my data? Can you tell me if I'm conscious? So that's the purpose of a prototype. We talked about iterations. We really tested how people interacted with the chatbot, what was missing, returned to the basis. A lot of it was missing. You saw how robotic the voice sounds like. We just didn't deepfake. We hadn't deepfaked the voice yet, but we're working. And, voice elements. How could we deepfake his voice? But we really worked also on the story, going back to why this project. And we had down like, okay, people now understand. The narrative has like four chapters where it first shows you how it runs on data. Then it shows you how natural language processing works. Then it shows you how algorithms are trying to solve problems by competing with each other and competing, making one data compete with the other. And then it shows you, you know, opens up questions about deepfakes. But what it still couldn't do was, Noam Chomsky's insistence was, humans have an inner capacity for freedom that relates to their capacity for creativity, inquiry or curiosity, and collaboration. And we didn't have that in the project. So how do we bring that back in? How do we bring the human back into the equation? I worked, there was a pandemic. It took long, that's why it took so many years. We stopped, it's National Film Board of Canada, it's bureaucratic. So even through the pandemic, nobody could work on the project, everything got stopped. We started again 2022 and we finished 2023 with this.
Chomsky versus Chomsky is a virtual reality experience. But in our special case, we're using artificial intelligence to talk about artificial intelligence.
I am what you could call an emulation of the voice and language patterns of Professor Noam Chomsky.
So, why Professor Noam Chomsky? Because Professor Chomsky has one of the largest, most extensive digital trace. Content in that digital trace is really, really diversified. That makes him a great case study to create a chatbot because of all these amazing digital traces. But he's also devoted his entire life to studying the mind.
I think the hardest thing about communication is understanding the intended meaning of a message.
The way that the AI interpreted my questions. So this was something that was very unique.
I wouldn't spoil anything else, but I would definitely ask them to think about what they would like to ask to Chomsky.
The first thing I thought when going out of the experience was to redo it right away.
The visuals were great. I mean, especially if you looked around, you really felt somewhere else.
We came up with that technique where we basically sliced the entire world up into a lot of different pieces that can turn individually at every time.
It has to be intuitive for the users to actually play with the data, play with this entity and engage and forget at some point about the technology and really dive in the story and the narrative we are telling.
At first I thought it was only me, and then at some point I realized that I can actually see the other people who are also part of the experience.
It's important that we are able to demystify AI to create an open conversation about artificial intelligence, especially at a time when we need one.
Still weird, a little less weirder, right? But this time, we wanted to fulfill the promise of peeking under. If we're saying it's about demystifying AI, what can we show about how AI works? And it wasn't perfect, but what you see on the left side here is you could, at some point of the experience, Chomsky shows you behind the hood. So you first start interacting with the entity. People really got into it. And once they started asking questions about what it was made of, we understood, oh, subject, what I'm made of, change chapters, show you how I'm made of. And when you would interact suddenly the answers, you could really see how the backend works. So you could see how the sentence could really change depending on percentages. So nobody really understood all the bases of artificial intelligence. But for some of our audience members, that became evident that it could not be sentient. Just because suddenly you realize, wait a minute, it said I was smart, and then I'm saying smart and it says funny. So it could have said I'm funny. So what did it mean exactly? What it didn't mean anything. It's just the percentage that algorithms are giving to predictability of the end of the sentence finishing by smart versus funny. But that's just predictive percentages according to what's most probable. What type of sentence has been used similarly the most online? But then we also had collaborative games that were super hard. That was hilarious to see people just fail at it. But winning was not the end game. It was showing them that they could actually collaborate. And AI systems are still today failing at collaboration. They cannot do it. They can't compete. They can't collaborate. And we have an instinct for it. So we can actually go like, I have no idea what this is. I think you need to push on your end. And everybody started going, no, 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 way too fast. No, no, slow, slow. Everybody started helping each other out to solve a puzzle that they can never solve. And Chomsky kind of judges you for it, but still. So very fast, because I'm going to show this other slide that you can take a, if you could screen cap that, and it has like a blog into what, how we used which technology and in which way. And why I'm showing this is because people are saying, so what did you use? GPT-2, GPT-3, GPT-3.5, what? All of the above. And we used 10 different AI systems, not one, to create the entity. But what's the most innovative use of technology that we used? Any guesses? It's transparency. It sounds philosophical, but it's actually true. The data scientists that we invited to witness the experience would all take pictures of this. In the end, it was an installation. They said, oh my God, you don't understand how helpful that is. And this is where people are getting really attracted by the innovation. It's not that it's that smart. It's that we share it openly. So another myth. I'm here to demystify. One of the myths is that the black box is so complex, we don't understand it. And more, even OpenAI has admitted that this is a fallacy. The black box is just called this because it's not opened. That's it. They won't show you what's happening behind. It's not that it's so complex you can't understand it. If you couldn't understand it, you can't make it. So you can understand it if they would share, and they don't share. So that just helped understand some of the things. I also want to say that we had a lot of humans working on this experience. And a lot of humans between Germany and Canada, so not always agreeing with ways of working and doing. And I think our disagreements helped us make the experience a little bit more thought-provoking. And so please go and see how it was made. But I will be willing to share more of this with you on the one-on-ones if you have questions about what's the difference between ChatGPT, GPT-2, GPT-3.5, GPT-3. I'm willing to share. That's what we've been doing. And you'll see a lot of it is scripting. And they go, oh, but yeah, but that's not real AI. Well, then guess what? ChatGPT is scripted. Yes, ChatGPT runs on GPT 3.5 or 4 or their next iteration. These are the ones that are available to the public. They run on their own. But ChatGPT is an application, just like Chomsky is an application. And so it is scripted. What means being scripted, I'm going to show you in a second. How are we on attention span? Still ready for sex? Sorry, what? Everybody raised an ear. I mean, sex, desires, and data. It was just funny to see your faces. Sorry, guys. I should have switched the camera so the people could see it. I went like smile, unsure. That's the entire experience of sex, desires, and data. Where do the algorithms come from? I'm going to try to pick it up the speed a little bit and then a little bit more as we go along. But where does the data come from? We've asked that question a lot. And I think we've pointed really rightfully to the fact that there's so much bias in the data already. But there's so much bias where we don't even hear about. This is a project that came on to me. What I mean by this is that a team, Club Sexu, are a group of young people working on inclusive and positive sexual education. So they do events, they do comedy shows, you know, concerts, where the goal is to talk to younger generation about diversity in sexual representations, gender representations, and just the way we talk positively and not always negatively about sexuality. And they said, well, we want to do an experience. It could be a VR experience. And the more we talked, the more we thought, this is so weird, because it's funny that you want to create a chatbot that can flirt. That was the initial ask. There's so many relationships between sex and data that we don't see. I didn't think I was going to talk about that today with you guys. I didn't think that was my prerogative to do that in for a living either. But while I was doing Chomsky, every time that we would talk to data scientists, they would say, don't judge me. Okay, so these are algorithms for Pornhub, and they're the most popular ones that you need to know if you were going to work in AI. So algorithms created by Pornhub to analyze how people reacted to specific content are the ones used by companies like Netflix to do the same with content. So pornographic categorization algorithms are running the data science world right now, or at least they're considered like a way forward to really do good data analysis of human interactions online. But there's more to it. If you talk about generative AI, so yesterday we were shown, for instance, your character, your prompt said, women 63 or 68, and she was ravishingly looking like 25 with gray hair. But we say all the data and the sexification of just typing in women as a prompt, and where does that come from? And then you talk to developers and they go, well, you know, the source. Like, what's the source? Well, the source of the images online that we share that are just objectifying women, it's partly true. But data also shows us that between 20 to 30% of what we share online is porn. So let me sink that in. So you will not all talk about porn. It's not going to be my fault. It's just a necessity that we understand how pervasive data is becoming. We share sexual explicit material online that is already part of an economy that is really, really biased. And that can constitute between, sorry, I said 20%, it's not true. It's between 10 and 30%. Nobody knows because it's really hard to evaluate, but it's like an approximation. And that almost between 10% to a third of the internet is what constitutes our databases for these AI systems. So when we're generating images and the skin looks always the same in Midjourney, it's partly because it's looking at pornographic images. It just says, I want skin, and it says a third of what's available is porn. So then we wonder about bias. So there's bias in the way the system is built, there's bias in the data, and there's so much bias in the available data that we don't even think about. So we had a huge subject. What are we gonna do with this? We don't know. Yes. Yes, please, because I'm like on a rant now. Or sexually biased image. But they don't really have guardrails, because they do in their sense of understanding where the problem is. What I mean by this is, speaking with a developer, the developer said or mentioned, for instance, well, where else, you know, again, big data, you remember, more data, more accuracy, more realism in the image. That was like a way of seeing things. The more the data, the better. But that's also a biased perception of data. Some data scientists would tell you the cleaner the data, the better. Not the more, the better. Where does that come, the more the better and the bigger the better? You know, there's like this way of seeing the more the data, the better. So when you were speaking with my developer in this case, his instinct was to say, well, of course, it needs a lot of skin. So where else do you think it's going to look for? And I said, dermatology websites? Like, why would skin mean porn? And it's just, that's so, what I mean is the guardrail of the conceptualization of just bringing more data is also, there's no guardrail for that. But then they think the guardrail will be non-pornographic, like as a negative filter, but it still seeps through, because then you have erotic images, you have highly sexualized biased images, and that is still getting through. That's why Violetta was showing us, I just said jeans and t-shirt and look what it's giving me back. Or you have a lot of animes. Right, you a lot of anime for the same reason, it's just so readily available.
that would, if Midjourney was to say we make a decision not to crawl this website, that would probably lower that percentage.
They could make that decision.
And as far, and your research is showing that they're not. They're like, they're slurping that up just as much as they're slurping up Wikipedia.
Their concept is more images better. But that has a fallacy for artists. I was at a conference where the speakers were telling us, see how great it is. I can say, okay, Pixar style bunny with like proportions from like Zootopia and like a driving car, a little bit like movies from the 80s, especially the Steven Spielberg ones. And then that's the prompt. And they were boasting, the better and more specific the prompt, the better. And I said, no, the more IPs you're stealing, the better, right? Because I've just mentioned all of this and you all had an image in your mind. You're faster than the AI to create it. You've all had that image in your mind. But to create it, you would have to access all of this. And would you get access? No, you wouldn't. So it's just like a automated theft. And there's ways that systems could decide not to do that. The proof is negative prompts. And I'm going to talk about negative prompts because we didn't want to have ethically problematic material. So we use negative prompts. And that made me think, well, one of the negative prompt could be individual names or company names. So you couldn't use Pixar, Disney, Brett Gaylor. You couldn't use these specific prompts. It's a negative prompt, so you cannot use them. So why don't they use it to protect IPs, individuals, artists, human rights? Yeah, okay. So I can. So this is what it looked like. So I'm just going to show quickly while I talk. It had games. So for people who didn't know what dating apps were, just so they could get acquainted. But we would also give them data, you know, 1 out of 2 North American under 35 is on dating apps. So that's a lot of data as well. And we partner with a variety of artists that just had their personal take on how data related to intimacy. Show Me Yours was about sex work, and that's changed a lot of prostitution changing because they sometimes can have clients without accessing these clients. So you would think that protects them better because everything's done at a distance, but then they're tethered 24 hours, no break, and they're really treated like data. So you have like all these ethical problems to discuss. And we had a chatbot called Max that you could interact with just to see a little bit more about how systems could be rigged to chat with you. So the flirty chatbot. I tried to film. Okay, so I'm going to try to go fast. Aww. I will tell you more about results on one-on-ones. Results was exactly digging into the heavy duty of the subject that I didn't want to get into. And I thought, oh my God, it's going to attack me because we were many directors, 4 directors for this piece, but I was given everything AI because nobody wanted to touch that. And one of them was talking about pornography and algorithms and data. So we actually trained an AI on 25 million pornographic videos. I didn't watch them. We used the self-identifications of these videos as categories. And then we had a room where people could interact by moving in space with a LiDAR. So they were scanned with a LiDAR just to know where they are in space. So it would generate a category that you may or may not like. It's just like discovering a category. I discovered category that I didn't know existed. And so you discover a category, and that category, the AI is trying to get better and better and better and more resembling reality. Trigger warning. I'm not going to show any skin, nudity, or porn. But the goal is that you can really like shackles. So it goes to shackles. You kind of see something, but you're not sure what you're seeing. And that's exactly what we did. We used negative prompts to break the system. We said, okay, first of all, let me make this about
shackles. Or let's, I think there's another category starting soon. 5 minutes, I was talking to be fast. Change, change. One of the category friends, I think that weightlifting is an actual category. Looking online at weightlifting, I asked, can weightlifting train on board? Okay, you see images that are never more realistic, look like pornography, and we keep telling it. No, no, wrestling. Like this, wrestling. Look for patterns, colors,
movement, textures, sounds. Use that to generate something, but don't look for realism. And you're wrong. So we would say, okay, I'm looking for blonde. And go, ooh, blondes. And then it tries to get really realistic. And right before it did, we say, sorry, blonde, 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 blonde. And it goes, I don't know what to look for. So we broke the system, but it created these images that I thought were very poetic and so weird. And weirdly, people felt like they were seeing something they were not supposed to be seeing, which I thought was hilarious, because can somebody describe? It's just like very hard to say what we're watching. And then Max, a little demonstration, but I can do this one-on-one. We would just chat with Max. This is me this morning. I tried to, we could test Max live, but because of the internet, I decided to just record. But you talk a little bit to Max, and Max is a bit sassy, funny, and weird. But just for that to be able to happen, we had to work against the machine. So we used OpenAI and ChatGPT, and it kept being very corporate. So we had to use ways of detouring the way it's made and tap into how are people talk, like, okay, so I said, what are you doing right now? I said, I'm testing you in front of, this is me this morning, sorry. So I was like trying to imagine that I was in front of you. I'm testing you in front of an audience. Oh, that's stressy. I hope you like me. I was like, okay, well, what did I say? I know you, unsure how people will feel. Okay. I'm going to close up with this before. Yeah. Okay. You can get ghosted too. Are you a little spoon or the big one? I'm a what? I'm like, I'm not familiar with the terminology. I think it's a very Anglophone terminology. I'm an efficient teddy bear. Okay. Fine. Goes, your whatever shape fits perfectly into our cozy love sandwich. In my opinion, it's everything's drawer or nothing at all. Fork, whisks, potato peelers, you name it. And I'm like, okay. But that's not me making it. That's the chatbot coming up with a way of discussing that that doesn't feel like ChatGPT. Okay, so I asked, what is it? It's a glitchy disco ball at a Burning Man, constantly reflecting different facets of existently while grieving to my own algorithmic beats. I was like, oh, what? I wasn't expecting Burning Man. So yeah, so that gives you a little bit oversight. But that all that chatbot was also, what am I watching? Yeah, that's just a snippet of it. That's just the intro. But this is what it looked like. What I meant is that it's also highly scripted. What it means by scripted, it will say like GPT optional. So we're deciding, should it go to GPT or not GPT? And then if it goes to GPT and has a pause, can you stop the pause and then it still goes to GPT? Or if it doesn't go to GPT, what does it say? And that takes a lot of human knowledge about conversations. Yes, I talk a lot, but that also means I know a lot about how people talk. It takes a lot about knowledge about human conversations to make it sound natural. And sometimes I'm just thinking ChatGPT is also using a lot of people to write ChatGPT in a way that feels more natural. And this, I'm not showing you. We're going to talk about in person about body movement, but this is the new project. It was just to get you inspired in the closing part. But we can create, we can detour tools such as this tool that helps deepfake people into becoming ballet dancers. Like these are the target subjects, how badly they're moving, and look, ta-da! I saw this and I thought like, we need to use this in an experience. Okay, that's my conclusion. Creating with AI or any new tool that's going to come down the pike, whether it be that thing on the right, is an act of resistance. Why it's resistance? Because we are here. We are as unique as we can be, and we are as diverse as we can be. And humans have a capacity to constantly reinvent themselves and adapt, and AI systems don't. So if we are deciding that we need to become bots ourselves so that we fit into the systems, we're just becoming the AI. And we're keeping pretending that the AI is us. So now what? And that's my conclusion. Humans, again, we like to disrupt things. I just like that image of Midjourney. As soon as it was out, people are like, Jack Black playing blackjack. You're just seeing how you can break it. This is about us becoming machines. That tool didn't work really well until they put a timer. Why? Because with a timer, we are so good at adapting that we've adapted our way so that the machine works really well. Without the timer, it didn't work. It didn't recognize anything I was doing. And then suddenly the same tool had a timer, and then it succeeded. Because it says, you need to draw something that I will understand in 10 seconds. So you cannot be poetic. You have to be direct. But that's cultural, again, biased. If you look at the fine lines, I know you're thinking like, but finish already. But if you look at the fine lines, OpenAI is saying, we are getting to general artificial intelligence. And then the fine lines are like, well, hypothetically, not really, and not as fast as we expected. But, you know, we could get there if you all agree to what we're doing. That's kind of what it's saying. You need to read at the fine lines. You need to see at how people are talking about what creativity means, and shows that they've never been artists. So Sebastian Trun, I think his title just speaks for itself. Stanford University, AI self-driving cars. It says, you know, artists have like a stroke of genius. Really? Is that how it works? We only have like strokes of geniuses, and we can, but AI can like know what is good art. And I thought, bigger art, faster art, better art. Which artist can define that? If you are an artist, you don't know how to define that, first of all. So, you know, the way we talk about the technology, when they have you convinced that it works like your brain, then they say, okay, is creativity overrated? I'm like, what? You mean the fact that we have fire is overrated? The fact that we invented AI is overrated? I think it's very dangerous when you start to have these discourses that being creative, having minds, and thinking for yourselves are dangerous and overrated. And I think when you look at who's calling the shots, and calling the bluff, these are the people calling the bluff, and they have been for years. And then you see how rigged the system is, and then you start to question it. The way we talk about, and it's really my conclusion, I swear, the way we talk about technology matters. We say artificial intelligence, and it has the word intelligence in it. And we say it's machine learning, and it has the word learning in it. And we say it's generative creativity, and it has the word creativity in it. I like that this is a former Italian diplomat, a member of the parliament, former Italian member of the parliament, who suggested another word for what it does, and said it's a systematic approach to learning algorithms and machine inference. It's a salami. It's not AI, it's salami. Will a salami take my job? Will I fall in love with a salami? Could the salami ever be creative? It changes the narrative, right? Just change your perspective. It changes the narrative. So now more than ever is the time to influence, challenge, disrupt, question the narrative. This on the right is what our brain's connections look like. They don't look like trees. They don't look like wires. They look like a bloody toddler mess. And that's what I love about it. Be in love with our messes means, you know, reassess our desire to disrupt, because it's part of who we are as humans and what makes us creative. Reassess our desire to come together, because we're really good at collaboration. We forget. And reassess our desire to find meanings. We're good at giving senses to even machines and what they're saying. And it could be gibberish, but we're like, that makes sense. Total makes sense. You know, iterate, transparency and accountability. We are designing futures for the way we're going to talk about technology and that how influences who gets to make it. Drop the mic. You've been super patient though. Like everybody's hungry and thirsty, I'm sure.
That was incredible. I'm sure you all agree we got a feast. We don't have time for questions, but that's okay because we're actually going to go out into breakout groups and discuss all of this. So, sorry, I shouldn't stand in front of the mic, the speaker. So what's going to happen now is you're all going to have a break. The bathrooms are just behind the bar there. If you just walk around the corner,